Hello everyone, welcome to the video lecture on Applied Hydraulics. In this video lecture, we'll be discussing about belt and wheel. These are the contents what we'll be discussing. We'll be discussing about introduction to belt and wheel, important belt and turbine installation, construction and working of belt and turbine, work done and efficiencies of belt and turbine. Now, coming to the introduction of belt and turbine is also called as belt and wheel. Now, belt and turbine is called as impulse turbine. Why it is called as impulse turbine? An impulse turbine is a turbine wherein the energy available at the inlet of the turbine, that is just before the striking, the energy available is purely kinetic energy. Belt and turbine requires high head and low rate of flow. This turbine is a tangential flow turbine. As in the figure, you can see the jet is hitting the runner of the turbine in the tangential way. This turbine has been named after American engineer named Lester Allen Pelton. Now, these are some of the important installations of Pelton turbine in India and the neighboring countries. The source for this is NPTEL. Now, before we discuss about the construction and working of Pelton turbine, let me show you a video on working of Pelton turbine, which will give you an idea or insight regarding the working of Pelton turbine.
The old water wheel is the precursor to modern Pelton turbines. Wood water wheels have been used to extract power from flowing water and convert it into mechanical power since the 3rd century. Often, water wheels provided power for water mills, which used millstones for grinding wheat to produce flour. The rotational movement of the water wheel spun the runner stone of the mill by means of a gear unit. The opening in the middle of the runner stone is called eye, where the grains were filled in two. As the runner stone turned, the grains were being cut and crushed by the stones that turned the grains into flour. The water wheel has long been replaced by the Pelton turbine for several reasons. Because of their clever design, Pelton wheels are far more efficient than water wheels of the past. The rotational movement of the turbine is usually transmitted to a generator, converting kinetic energy into electrical energy. A series of spoon-shaped buckets is mounted around the edge of the Pelton wheel. Buckets are usually cast as one solid piece, which is necessary to avoid damage, such as fatigue failure. The buckets have splitters placed at the middle of them that divide the water jets into two equal streams. The divider splits the flow of water striking it and changes the direction of the water by almost 180 degrees. This allows the wheel to capture almost 100% of the water's energy. The water jet can reach speeds of up to 370 miles per hour, resulting in a very high rotational speed of the wheel. Pelton wheels can be operated with almost 3,000 rotations per minute. Pelton turbines can be installed horizontally as well as vertically. When mounted vertically, several nozzles can be employed, resulting in high turbine speeds.
Now, coming to the construction and working of Pelton turbine, a Pelton turbine consists of a rotor, at the periphery of which are mounted equally spaced double hemispherical or double ellipsoidal buckets. Now, water is transferred from the high end source through penstock. Penstock are nothing but pipes of larger diameter which will be carrying water under pressure Now, as I said, water is transferred from the high end source through the penstock, which is fitted with a nozzle. Now, as water passes through the nozzle, it gets converted into high speed jet. A needle spear moving inside the nozzle controls the water flow through the nozzle. At the same time, it provides the smooth flow with negligible energy loss. So here you can see there's a needle spear, and this needle spear is used to control the flow of the turbine. So by moving inside and outside, we can control the rate of flow. Now, because of the nozzle, all the potential energy is converted into kinetic energy just before the jet hits the buckets of the turbine. The pressure all over the wheel is constant and is equal to atmospheric pressure, so that the energy transferred to the wheel of the turbine is due to the impulse action. Hence, this turbine is known as impulse turbine. The Pelton turbine is provided with a casing to prevent splashing of water and to discharge the water to the tail race. When the nozzle is completely closed, by moving the spear in the forward direction, the amount of water striking the runner is reduced to zero. But due to inertia, the runner continues revolving for a long time. So in order to bring the runner to rest in a short interval of time, brake nozzle has been provided. So this brake nozzle, we will be having a jet of water, and this jet of water will be hitting the back of the vanes of the turbine. So this jet of water is called as braking jet. So this is the rotor to which double hemispherical or double ellipsoidal buckets have been fixed. So this is the double hemispherical or double ellipsoidal bucket. Now, this is the sectional view of the bucket. So here you can see the splitter. The jet which is coming out of the nozzle hits the splitter symmetrically and gets distributed into two halves as shown in the figure. The bucket center line cannot be exactly made in the form of a mathematical cusp, because the jet invariably carries particles of sand and other materials which tend to wear it down. So the inlet of the jet of the turbine, it will be in between 1 to 3 degrees, but for all practical purposes, the angle made by the jet at the inlet is considered to be zero. Now, we cannot go for exactly hemispherical vane. Why? Because if we go for exactly hemispherical vane, the jet after hitting this outgoing jet will be hitting the back of incoming vane, which will be reducing the overall efficiency of the turbine. So in practice, we will be designing the vanes in such a way that the deflection of the jet in the bucket is limited to 165 to 170 degrees. Thereby, this bucket is slightly smaller than a hemisphere in size. So this is the front view of the double hemispherical or double ellipsoidal bucket. So this is the point where the jet is hitting. So these are some of the important relationship which we need to remember for designing the Pelton wheel turbine. Now, coming to the work done and efficiency of the Pelton turbine. Now, this is the inlet diagram of the Pelton turbine, and this is the outlet velocity triangle diagram of the Pelton turbine. So, before we discuss about the inlet velocity triangle and the outlet velocity triangle, let us discuss about the notations what we will be using here. So here N is the speed of the wheel in RPM, capital D is the diameter of the wheel or rotor, small d is the diameter of the jet, U is the peripheral velocity of the runner. So this peripheral velocity is same at the inlet and outlet of the runner. So therefore we can say that U1 is equals to U2 is equals to U. So the peripheral velocity or speed is given by U is equals to pi dN by 60. V1 is the absolute velocity of jet at inlet. VR1 is the relative velocity of jet. And vane at inlet. Alpha is the angle between the direction of jet and direction of motion of the vane. Theta is the angle made by the relative velocity VR1 with respect to the direction of motion at inlet. VW1 and VF1, these are the component of velocity of jet in the direction of motion and perpendicular to the direction of motion of the vane respectively. VW1 is whirl velocity at inlet, VF1 is velocity of flow at inlet. V2 is the velocity of jet at outlet. VR2 is the relative velocity of jet with respect to the vane. Beta is the angle made by the absolute velocity of jet V2 with respect to the direction of motion of the vane at outlet. Pi is the angle made by the relative velocity VR2 with respect to the direction of motion of the vane at outlet. VW2 is the whirl velocity at outlet. VF2 is the velocity of flow at outlet. Now, as I have said, the inlet angle of the jet is in between 1 to 3 degrees, but it is always assumed to be 0. So if the angle made by the jet with respect to the direction of motion of the vane, if it is 0, so inlet velocity triangle will be a straight line. Now, so as I said, alpha is equals to 0, therefore the relative velocity with which the jet strikes the vane, that is VR1, will be the algebraic difference between the velocity of the jet and velocity of motion of the vane. So VR1 is equals to V1 minus U1. Since U1 is equals to U, so we can write the relative velocity VR1 as V1 minus U. Also, the whirl velocity is equals to the velocity of the jet at inlet. And as I have mentioned, alpha is equals to 0. Since alpha is equals to 0, theta will also be equals to 0. Now, coming to the velocity triangle diagram at outlet. Now, VR2 is the relative velocity of the jet at the outlet. This relative velocity of the jet at outlet, we can write it as K times of VR1, where K is the blade friction coefficient. This blade friction coefficient may be slightly less than 1. If the blade surfaces, that is the vane surfaces, are perfectly smooth and the energy loss due to impact at the splitter is neglected, so K will be equal to 1. So we can say that VR2 is equals to VR1. Now, VW2, that is the velocity of whirl at the outlet, is given by VR2 cos pi minus U2. So VW2 will be equal to VR2 cos pi minus U, since U1 is equals to U2 is equals to U. So depending upon the magnitude of the peripheral speed, the unit we can classify it as slow, medium or fast runner. And depending upon the angle beta, VW2 will be varying as follows. For slow runner, beta is acute, so VW2 will be negative. For medium runner, beta is equals to 90 degrees, VW2 will be equal to 0. For fast runner, VW2 is greater than 90. for fast runner, sorry, beta is greater than 90, so VW2 is positive. Now, the force exerted by the jet of water in the direction of motion of the is given by Fx is equals to, of course, this is mass of water striking per second into inlet velocity minus final velocity. So if we simplify this, mass of water striking per second, here it is rho a v1, inlet velocity of the jet, here it is vw1, and outlet velocity, here it will be vw2. So here rho is the density of water and a is area of jet. So work done per second on the vane by the jet is given by the product of force into the distance per second in the direction of force, that is F into U. So if we substitute the value, F is rho a v1 into vw1 plus vw2 into U. So work done per second per unit weight of fluid striking per second is given by ratio of work done per second divided by weight of fluid striking per second. So work done per second is given by rho a v1 into vw1 plus vw2 into U, and weight of the fluid striking is given by g into rho a v1. So here mass of water striking per second, here it is rho a v1. So rho a v1 into g is the weight of the fluid striking per second. So if we simplify this, we will be getting the work done per second as U into vw1 plus vw2 divided by g. One more important point here is, since at any instant of time, one or the other vane will be facing the jet, so mass of water striking per second will be rho a v1. In previous case, we may have considered as rho a vr1 also. So here, this case is similar to force exerted by the jet on a series of curved vanes. That is why mass of water striking per second will be rho a v1. Now, work done per second per unit mass of the jet, we will be getting it as U into vw1 plus vw2. So the energy supplied by the jet at the inlet, it is in the form of kinetic energy, and it is given by half m v1 square. So if we substitute the value of m, it is rho a v1. If we simplify, we will be getting it as half rho a v1 cube. The hydraulic efficiency is defined as work done per second on the vane divided by initial kinetic energy of the jet per second. So if we substitute the value, so rho work done per second on the vane is rho a v1 into vw1 plus vw2 into U, and kinetic energy of the jet per second is half rho a v1 cube. So if we simplify, it will be 2 into vw1 plus vw2 into U divided by v1 square. Now, from inlet velocity triangle diagram, we know that vw1 is equals to v1, and the relative velocity vr1, it is v1 minus U, and also vw2 is vr2 cos pi minus u2. So this vr2 cos pi I can write as k into vr1, cos pi remaining as it is. So vr1 is nothing but v1 minus u. If I substitute and if I simplify, so vw2 I'll be getting it as k into v1 minus u whole into cos pi minus u. So if I substitute the value of vw1 and vw2 in this equation, I can simplify the equation for hydraulic efficiency. So hydraulic efficiency is given by, so in place of vw1 I am writing v1 directly, so in place of vw2 I am writing k into v1 minus u cos pi minus u divided by v1 square will be as it is. So this whole equation, that is 2 into vw1 plus vw2 into u, so in place of vw1 and vw2 I have made substitution. So if we simplify, hydraulic efficiency will be 2 into v1 minus u plus 1 plus k cos pi into u divided by v1 square. Now, for a given value of jet velocity, the efficiency will be maximum when d eta h by du is equals to 0. So therefore, we need to differentiate this above equation with respect to u and equate it to 0. So here, 2 into 1 plus k cos pi divided by v1 square, we cannot equate it to 0. Therefore, we will be differentiating v1 minus u into u. So differentiation of v1 minus u into u, it will be v1 minus 2u, and this we will be equating it to 0, since we cannot equate 2 into 1 plus k cos pi divided by v1 square equal to 0. So v1 minus 2u is equal to 0, so u is equal to v1 by 2, which means that the hydraulic efficiency of the Pelton wheel will be maximum when the velocity of vane is half the velocity of jet. Now, in order to get the condition for maximum efficiency, substitute the value of u, which is v1 by 2. So if we simplify, we'll be getting the maximum efficiency as 1 plus k cos pi divided by 2. So this equation is same as the force exerted by the jet on a series of curved vanes. So there also we had got as 1 plus cos pi divided by 2. So if the friction factor k is 1, we'll be getting the hydraulic efficiency, that is the maximum hydraulic efficiency, as 1 plus cos pi divided by 2. These are my references. Thank you.